Wait till you hear this. It's incredible. You know what Riker's up to?
Echo.
Hey, you saw it. Smart. How'd you figure it out? The tables.
Yeah, I found them in Riker's room.
Yeah. This is a very clever trick. Can you imagine it? He comes here, he finds the Nambas with a strong cargo cult, opens his little book of tables, checks his clock, says, bingo! The big white bird will arrive now!
Never mind how we did it. This cargo actually landed.
What do you got there? Luna altimeter. Kilometers, 160. Goliath, 7. General Electric Corporation. Was this in his room, too?
No, the kid gave it to me. The witch doctor's son.
You talk to me about cargo cults. I'm telling you, you don't know anything. You come here with your accusations, your delusions, your bloody nonsense. You say you want a mission established here, eh? You want to give my friends religion? I tell you, the jungle has its own logic. You don't know anything, any of you. You think you're in the real world out there. Nonsense! Bloody nonsense! The great powers, the Western technocracies, Let me tell you something. The entire space program is just a symptom of an unconscious malaise afflicting mankind. Here, in the jungle, where the unconscious is manifest and exposed, there's no need for these insane projections. Your capsule, your space capsule, sir, it's just a fragment of the huge disintegrating fantasy that the white man has lived in since the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. It's all sacrifice. Do you hear me? Blood of the Lamb, astronauts, vectors of the material world, exploding egos, Freud, the works. It makes me sick to think about what you idiots are up to. You hear me? So don't moralize to me. Don't talk to me about space. I know what space is.
Well?
He admitted it. Yeah, he had no choice. Without his little book of satellite tables, his life here would be unacceptable.
What about Spender?
The Nambas got him. Riker said he could do nothing to help him.
That's a lie. He was able to save me when the Nambas thought I'd landed.
Things were different.
That's incredible. He'd been fooling them with the Echo satellite, but they were getting bored, impatient. So when Spender came down in Goliath, great. Because now the Nambas will watch Echo and wait for the next landing forever.
Exactly. Sancho! Sotero Cabo!
Connelly! You've got my box of tricks there! Connelly! Connelly! Damn you, sir!
Captain, what actually happened to Kurt Spender? He said the Nambas wouldn't eat a white man.
They eat their gods.
They have come and they have found what they were looking for. Although they did not find me, a prisoner in the body of Tommy Tom Tom. I have been to the moon, and I have returned to be reborn a god. I shall be greater in magic than my father, who has made the body of the reptile sacred despite his treacherous death. Tonight, he will come from the river on his belly and find Riker, the false prophet, who now weeps upon the bank where the animals drink at sunset. It will come to pass, for I am magic. I have been to the moon.
Question of Reentry by J.G. Ballard, dramatized by Lawrence Russell, starring Graham Campbell as Riker, Geza Kovacs as Pereira, Elliot McIver as Tommy, and Ron White as Connolly. The series script editor is Sandra Rabinovich. Casting consultant, Beth Russell. Original music was by Timothy Clark. The recording engineer was Glenn McLaughlin. Sound effects by Kathy Perry. Production assistant, Nina Callahan. A Question of Re-entry was produced and directed at Studio G in Toronto by series executive producer William Lane. Next week, news from the sun. Until then, I'm Barbara Budd. Good night.
Now a track called Drift. You can find it on YouTube. Kathy Marston, who's the choreographer and dancer on this video, but I found this through my cousin Sarah Tricky, who plays violin, and this is part of trying to make contact with the classical journey on Phonic FM and trying to find out if all forms of music are moving into video promotion and shorter extracts perhaps of a longer work. And this is complete, but it's just sort of trying to find out what's happening with classical music and if radio is changing along with that. I'll just read out the description from YouTube. Drift is a film featuring choreographer Kathy Marston improvising for the camera on the banks of the River Aar in Bern, Switzerland. It was filmed in August 2020 by director stroke editor Felix von Meralt. Music specially written by composer Philip Feeney and performed by violinist Sarah Tricky with Philip Feeney on the piano. And the dress is by fashion designers Viento. And all the web contacts, if you find this on YouTube, just look for Drift and Kathy Marston, all one word. Thank you.
106.8 FM.
I might have meant to plead for the monster's life, but I hadn't done that. And the gods would have been much. But there was no point getting worried about it. We were soon back in the sea, and Gilgamesh was making songs about himself. And I went back to my normal life. Well, it was some time after. It was a Wednesday, because I was playing backgammon. I'm lucky at backgammon. When the youngest of all the guards, he came a-running in, and he said,
"Oh, have you seen that out there? Did you see? Oh, there was the Lady Ishtar. I swear it was her. And this terrible, huge, great big chariot, all gold and lapis lazuli and dragons and hippogriffs and I don't know what else."
And we had to run out, and there she was, flying down, the Lady Inanna Ishtar, goddess of love, goddess of war. And she was rayed in unguents. You could smell her from where we were, and she had biffins and dragons drawing a golden and silver chariot. She was come to woo. And as we watched, she drove down to the temple and landed in the precinct, and then went up to the palace nearby, the holy ziggurat in which Gilgamesh lived. And I thought to myself, "All right, I'm gonna make myself scarce." So I went off and I won 3 more games of backgammon. When all of a sudden, there was a noise like thunder! Roaring through the city, and we ran out. And there was the Lady Inanna Ishtar, her face black with fury. The dragons turned black, with black lightning streaking behind them, and red lightning coming from the griffins and the hippogriffs. And she rode up in full fury, off to the firmament of Anu, off to the vault of the stars. Well, I went and scrambled in. I scrambled into the palace, and there I found King Gilgamesh. He was a-thinking, and looking long. "Here, mister, what have you been doing to the Lady Ishtar? She came to woo you."
"Yes,
what did you say to her?"
"Well, I turned her down."
"What? Didn't you want her as a lover?"
"I said to her, Enkidu, I said to her, I will be your lover, and I would give you everything that I could, everything that..."
"Well, what annoyed her then?"
"But I will not be your husband," which is what she wanted me for, "because being married to you," I said, "it would be like being behind a back door that let in a draft, being in a fortress that was no bastion and fell on all the guards in it and killed them all. Think, man."
"Oh, yes,
remember,
you're right.
Her husbands, there was Tammuz, the shepherd boy. What happened to him, hey?"
"The shepherd boy, yeah. Oh, yeah, she was with him all summer long. He was so happy."
"Yes, he loved her dearly until she turned him into a wolf, and so that he was hunted by his own fellow shepherds."
"She said he got boring."
"Oh,
yeah,
exactly."
"Oh, and then there was that merchant. He was as rich as Croesus."
"Yes, he gave her everything."
"Yeah, he had all the gems at the world at his disposal."
"Exactly."
"He smothered her in jewels."
"Yes,
she still wears them."
"Was she grateful? She turned him into a mole, calling him boring, and made him ever blind and always seeking."
"Oh, yeah, and then she killed him and had him on her back. Where's
as a coat, yes. Charming, yes.
Hang on, there was the horse."
"Exactly, the horse who she loved for his endurance, and him, when she got bored with him, she decreed for him the whip and the spur. Lovely."
"What about the lion?"
"Yes, him she loved for his courage, and him, for him, when she got bored with him, for him she decreed 7 pits and 7 times 7. No, Enkidu, I would not marry the Lady Ishtar. I would rather be her enemy than have her as my friend."
"But what about it, though? What do you think she's doing now?"
"I know not."
"And now we've annoyed 2 gods."
"Yes."
"And that's the charm."
"I know."
"How could we really know, though? Even at that moment, Inanna Ishtar was standing before her father, the god Anu, lord of the firmament, and saying,
Father, I went down to see he, King Gilgamesh, and he insulted me so badly. I am so angry. You will give me the bull of heaven in order to enact my revenge. And if you do not, I will cause a drought, and all your people will die, for it will last for 7 years, unless you give me the bull of heaven.
But the Lady Inanna was cunning. She laid a black curse on that bull. For the first that struck it and drew blood
should die of the black plague in agony.
But we knew nothing of it. The first we actually knew was a sound like a bellow, a mighty bellowing bull! Sounding through the sea, and all the people were running and running and running. And Gilgamesh had strapped on his armor, and I put on my helmet. And down we went through the city's ways. And there was the great bull, and it had just battered down the walls of Uruk. And then it turned on us with its lapis lazuli eyes, and spitting fire, it charged Gilgamesh. But Gilgamesh, he's nimble of foot, so he jumped on his back, bounced 3 times, and pulled its tail. But you'll have noticed before, I'm cunning before. So I had taken my space by the great bastion of Uruk. Now that wall, I remember Gilgamesh himself had told me, was the first stone that came after the flood. That wall had a charm on it. It would last aeons. It would last whatever demons threw at it. It was the founding stone of Uruk. So I stood with it at my back and I shouted, Mr. Bull! And the bull turned and he charged me. So I jumped to the left, nimble of foot, and the bull crashed into the wall and fell stunned. And before I could get up, I whipped out a dagger and I cut off its hind legs. And as it was floundering in fire and poison, Gilgamesh went on its back and struck it, cutting off its head. And he declared his triumph.
Victory is mine! Enkidu! Enkidu! What is this?
Black!
No! No! Do not leave me! You are my only equal! My only true companion! No! No.
I curse! I curse the seductress who brought me here! And I should die this way!
Do not curse her! She was the Shoujo beer! And the ways of the city and whole new things and we met.
I curse then. I curse the messenger, the huntsman, the curse of death. For I could have been happy
in the forest. For 7 long days and 7 long nights, he was so sick, so sick, so sick. And there was nothing I could do. I tried everything. I sent out all the priests to pray. Seven long days and 7 long nights, I lay asleep by his body, willing him to come back, hoping to warm him with the warmth of my body, but he was gone. And at the end of the 7th day, the worms had taken his body, and I knew then that he would not come back, that he was gone from me, that he was lost to me. My brother, my younger brother, was gone. And then I called upon the lamentation priests to pour out libations to the gods, and to lament, and to give praise songs in his memory. And I said, let the wolves lament in the forest, let the lions lament on the plain, let all the creatures of the forest lament, let the creatures of the air lament, let the river lament, let all my people lament for Enkidu. And then I called to me the goldsmiths and the silversmiths and the coppersmiths and the stonemasons, and I caused them to build a great statue of Enkidu, 3 times his own size, and gold it was, with accoutrements of lapis lazuli. And I had a great cedar bowl carved, and in it poured the finest honey and we gave libations to the gods in his memory. But I could not get over my grief. I could not stop grieving him. And even worse, it seemed to me, I could not bear to share his fate. That I, two-thirds God, could ever share his fate. I thought we would last forever. For he also, I thought, was divine. And so I went to my mother, Ninsen, the high priestess, and I said, Mother, I cannot get over his death. Is there no way I can bring him back?
No, no.
And if there is no way I can bring him back, there is there any way I can achieve immortality?
No. That is not destiny.
But I am two-thirds...
And one-third
God. I cannot bear to die.
No, only one man is granted immortality.
Who was that? Who is that?
Nepashtu.
He who we call the faraway.
Yes. He lives in the Garden of the Gods.
Well, then...
At the other side of the 12 leagues of darkness. Beyond the Scorpion Gate.
Beside the waters between the worlds. Well, in that case, I must visit him. I must go. I must go on quest and ask
if that is your destiny...
I
will not say no.
Thank you, Mother.
You may go with my blessing, my son.
I must go. And I cut my long hair in lament, and I went out. And I travelled and I journeyed, oh, so long, it seemed a year and a day. So, so long, and my clothes fell to pieces on the way, and my skin grew caked with filth, and my hair began to grow again, but it matted. I was so dirty and so ragged and haggard. I had to catch and kill wild beasts for my nourishment. And so, when my clothes fell to pieces, I finally, when I was cornered by some lions and managed to kill them, I skinned them and I wore their skins. Oh, I journeyed so long. But at long last, I saw ahead of me a great gate. The great Scorpion Gate. Huge they were. Half man, half dragon. And their tails met at the top. And I approached them, almost too weary to be...
Husband!
Yes.
Husband!
Yes, wife?
Who is that little man who comes?
It is Gilgamesh, King of Uruk.
Where does he go?
He comes seeking immortality.
Where does he go?
He wishes to meet with Utnapashtim, the faraway.
In the Garden of the Gods?
Yes, in the Garden of the Gods.
He will have to traverse the leagues of darkness.
He will.
It is kinder to kill him.
Perhaps it is, but that is not his fate.
Do we let him pass?
He shall pass. And so, I went under the great gate and came to the 12 leagues of darkness. And the first league, oh, it was in this plain that stretched for miles, leagues in every direction, uncountable, illimitable, and yet very, very far in the distance, I saw on the horizon what was maybe the hint of a mountain. But that first league, so dark, and at the end of the first league, it was like the blackest night ever. Starless, moonless, with no candles, no lamps, nothing to tell you where you were. And it was so, so dark. I'd never seen anything like it. And then during the second league of darkness, the darkness itself seemed to press upon my eyelids, my eyeballs. And then I entered before, I thought I could at least hear some breath of wind, but now all I could hear was my own breathing. And so I entered the fourth league of darkness, and the silence was so profound, and the air seemed so still, it seemed to start pressing upon my ears, upon my eardrums. And then I entered the fifth league of darkness, and you know how it is, you can always taste the air. And usually you're not aware of it because you can see and hear, but I was aware now that I had been dependent on the sense of taste, and I could only taste the salt of my own sweat. There was nothing in the air. And so I entered the sixth league of darkness, and the darkness itself seemed to press down upon my tongue, stopping my mouth. And so I entered the seventh league of darkness. And there, I could smell nothing, nothing at all. There was no scent, not the merest hint. Even in the desert, you could smell the sand. You could smell something of a distant air. There was nothing. And then it was in the eighth league of darkness that the darkness itself seemed to stop up my nostrils as it pressed down upon my ears and my eyes and on my tongue and down my throat. And then in the ninth league of darkness, I needed to persuade myself that this was still real, and I touched the ground, thinking to feel the sand of the desert plain, but it ran away from my fingers as if it were nothing, and I could feel nothing. And then in the tenth league of darkness, the darkness itself seemed to push down upon my hands and upon all of me, as well as into my eyes and into my ears and into my throat. And I began to lose the sense that I was even going in the right direction, though I kept on going, never deviating. And it was in the 11th league of darkness that I began to forget who I was, what I was doing, why I was here. And only my will carried me on through exhaustion. And finally in the 12th league of darkness, I saw at last a light at the edge. And then I saw the sun break through over the mountain. And I found myself out of the darkness and in the most beautiful garden I had ever seen. Well, there were the lapis lazuli leaves, and the fruits were of carnelian and rare agate and pearls of the sea, and it was dazzling after the darkness. And I saw a woman sitting there by a vine, and I said, "Who are you?" She asked me, and I said, "I am Gilgamesh, king
of..." "No! I have heard that Gilgamesh is a young man, beautiful, kingly, and you are an old man, and your skin is grey and sags."
"Oh, wherefore should I not be starved and my cheeks be gaunt and worn? I have travelled long to be here. 7 long days and 7 long nights I mourned by my brother's body, by Enkidu's body, till he turned to the worm. And then I came on a long, long journey here, and my clothes have fallen to pieces on the way. Wherefore should I not look older than
I am?" "And why are you here?"
"Who are you?"
"I am Siduri of the Vine. Why are you here?"
"I am here seeking Utnapishtim, he who we call the Far One."
"Why?"
"Because I must ask him how he alone of mankind achieved immortality."
"Why?"
"Because I do not want to die. I am 2/3 God."
"Why?"
"Why?"
"Why? Why will you not sit here and drink with me? Why will you not enjoy the taste of wine, the flavor of bread, the joy of life, of this wind in your hair?"
"Because I want them always, and I want my fame to last
throughout." "Those are feelings the gods themselves envy. Oh, Gilgamesh, don't seek immortality. Stay with me. Revel in your mortality. For it is the joy and the envy of the gods."
"I cannot. The divine in me calls out to be immortal, and I would do great deeds for all of time. I cannot, I must go on."
"Well, if you would go on, go up."
So I walked up the slope, up the mountain, and there at the top, there was a great hall with a golden door. And outside, there was a woman. And I said to her, "Who are you?"
"I am the wife of Utnapishtim. But who are you?"
"I am Gilgamesh, Lord of Uruk."
"Well, don't go inside like that."
"What do you mean? I must see him."
"And Gilgamesh strode inside."
"And I was amazed."
"For there was a figure looking furious at him."
That was Gilgamesh Part 2 from the Widsith and Deal Theatre. And that was recorded in Paris Street. There's several shops that can be used for different things. That sort of the other end from where Make Tank is, more towards the bus station, not the Siddle Street end. But Make Tank is going to have another event, or no, by the time this is on FM, on Phonic FM Thursday, the second anniversary will have happened. But it's all online anyway. So exactly which places we're relating to is a bit unclear. Still thinking about a temp radio studio that could be in a shop, or probably it's going to be online in some sort of format. The Lost Weekend has got something to do with it. I'm not quite sure how that's going to reappear. I mentioned Twitter before, Will789GP, and one of the tweets Bellhouse liked, so I asked them if I could use some sounds of theirs, and they've agreed to this, and they've suggested looking up bellhouseproject.co.uk, and I found I'm going to regard this as sort of chimes, but this is, you can find these on YouTube, I think, but probably through that site. The website is the easiest way of finding it, bellhouseproject.co.uk, and they've done work with Climate Europe, and this one is Predictor Climate Adjust.
Hey. can I change the world but can't change myself? How can I please the world but not God himself? How can I have the world still need some help? How can I see the world stuck in this box?
I've been trying to figure out my life. I can't see even in plain sight. Though I cry, my tears soon bring light. Your life is in your rear view.
How can I change the world but can't change myself? How can I please the world but not God himself? When I'm scared to try, why should I need the world? We all gonna die.
Oh, thank God for giving us this life. Day you're born, someone else dies. All in love, all is in life. Your life is in your rear.
Rear View, Raphael Sadiq from last year, I think quite recently anyway, Jimmy Lee CD. And before that, Ain't Got No Loot, Tony Instrumental, which is the sort of theme music for the We Not Know show. And now the Wild Show, in a sort of a way, trying out what you can do with Zoom, and including a sort of play based on visiting CD places, or places where CD shops used to be, HMV in London, for example, or HMV in Exeter. We'd have to set it a little bit in the future to do that one, but talking about how much space is needed for education, that's the play we will get back to eventually. So Chris, what? Let's move on to your show.
Okay. I'm bored.
You're very bored.
Yeah, missing being on Phonic FM and pressing all the buttons.
106.8 FM.
Well, yeah, you can't do it all on your computer or your phone, you don't think?
No. I don't think so. I could do bits and pieces. Like we've tried audio recordings.
Yeah.
And I can do those, and I can do this is a certain track and then get the track, but yeah. I can't mix the two together.
Right. Yeah, all of that is difficult.
Yeah. Have you tried Zoom with JD?
No, I haven't. I've only recently discovered that I think what it's doing is recording in the cloud and then it stores it on my computer. Whereas previously when I was trying to record Messenger, Facebook Messenger, I could either set Audacity to record the microphone or the stereo mix. I couldn't get it to get both voices at once. But I think this is working okay.
Yeah, well, we'll find out. This is my third Zoom call I've been involved in.
Okay.
Because my mum does it. No, it might be the fourth, actually.
Okay.
Because I signed up with an account very quickly a few years ago because to get onto a meeting with Carl.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Carl is normally way ahead of on this sort of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you haven't used it much since.
No, I've got it there. I've done four calls, so it's just with Facebook Messenger.
Yeah.
I know that.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think we can use that as well, but we can't record. We can't record all the voices. At least I don't think so. If anybody's listening,
no, I was just having a look. I don't think you can, because we're on iOS.
Well, you are.
Yeah, me and JD are on iOS.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't think you can record unless you're on Android, but I don't know.
No. Well, look, Chris, we'll see how this works.
Okay.
But also, are you doing your researching into Buddy Holly?
What research was that? I remember it vaguely.
Okay. Well, it goes like this, Chris. One of the songs you wanted me to play when I was in the studio in Phonet during the sort of break in the lockdowns.
Yeah.
I think was That'll Be the Day was a track that you.
Yeah. Was
on your list, and I was quite. I was quite surprised that you knew about Buddy Holly. And I thought it was a very good thing, because when we can move about again. I'm doing this at the moment as fantasy, as a sort of drama. But in reality, we could go to Paul McCartney Limited in Soho Square in London when we go up there for our walkabout.
Yeah.
And we could offer to promote Buddy Holly on our show.
Okay.
In return for a bit of support, a bit of help here and there, charging up our batteries, offering us the odd cup of coffee. And then we would walk about looking at the sites where the record shops used to be.
And who are we going to get to do this?
Well, it would be us. This would be, depending on who turns up. But we go up to London for the Bet show and we can do a few other things as well. So we've been walking around Central Exeter saying... There's not a lot of space needed to sell records, so we wonder what's going to happen to education. That's our sort of discussion. But we could do the same thing in London if we went from where the Virgin Megastore used to be, sort of Tottenham Court Road area.
Yeah.
We could walk down towards Piccadilly Circus where Tower Records used to be. And we'd get some help from Paul McCartney Limited, Soho Square. On our journey.
And then
we come back towards Oxford Street and find HMV. But I think HMV's been in different places along. You're zooming all over the place, Chris.
I'm moving my phone.
Right. So we'd find HMV somewhere on Oxford Street on the way back.
Yeah.
But you would need to bluff your way as a Buddy Holly expert, because we can't tell them we know all about Buddy Holly and we're going to promote Buddy Holly on the Wild Show, unless we know a bit more about it.
Okay.
But we're doing pretty well at the moment.
Well, that'll be the day when you say goodbye. Yes, that'll be the day when you make me cry. You say you're gonna leave, you know it's a lie. Cause that'll be the day when I die. Well, you give me all your loving and your dirty loving, all your hugs and kisses and your money too. Well, you know you love me, baby. Tell me maybe that someday, well, I'll be through. Well, that'll be the day when you say goodbye. Yes, that'll be the day when you make me cry. You say you're gonna leave, you know it's a lie. Cause that'll be the day when I die. You say you're gonna leave, you know it's a lie. Cause that'll be the day when I die. Well, when Cupid shot his dart, he shot it at your heart. So if we ever part, then I'll leave you. You sit and hold me and you tell me boldly that someday, well, I'll be through. Well, that'll be the day when you say goodbye. Yes, that'll be the day when you make me cry. You say you're gonna leave, you know it's a lie. Cause that'll be the day when I die. Well, that'll be the day. That'll be the day. That'll be the day. That'll be the day.
Do you know how I know about are you recording this?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's still being recorded, yeah.
Okay. Well, I have one CD of Buddy Holly.
What, a complete CD?
Yeah.
So how many songs is that?
I'd say 15.
Well, that's a lot. That's a 2-hour show. Several 2-hour shows, because we won't play all Buddy Holly. We'll play Buddy Holly every, well, 2 or 3 tracks a week.
Yeah. Do you know why I found that Buddy Holly track for you?
No, I'm not
because
sure.
Because it's mainstream. It's easy to find on YouTube.
Oh, well, that's true. Yes. Yes, but it we've got to have CDs as well.
Because there was no point saying a track I'd really like to hear and then you couldn't find it.
No, that's true.
So.
No, okay. No, well, we'll find some more obscure Buddy Holly tracks as well as it goes on.
Yeah.
Okay. Chris, look, do another request and then I'll mix it in somehow.
Okay. I'd like Elvis Presley Hound Dog.
Right. Okay. Well, I'll try that.
You should be able to find that one.
Yeah, I think so. Okay. Well, look, Chris, I think that's enough. I don't know how long this is, but...
Okay.
I'll stop there, and I'll see what I get, and I'll try and mix it up, and I'll send you a version of it.
Okay, thanks.
Later on.
Okay, bye.
Bye for now. Bye.
Phonic FM.
You ain't nothing but a hound.